everyone. Happy Friday. So I was hanging out on my balcony reading a little bit, and I thought I would chat with you guys and tell you what's going on this week in my life in engineering. So I've been a little shy on social media this week just because I've got some other things going on, and I needed a little bit of a break. So some of the other things were this operations and maintenance manual. I actually started the technical pieces of it. So instead of just looking at formatting and rearranging things and making sure the whole manual is consistent across all six volumes, I'm actually talking about how often you would lubricate the bearings, or how often you would make sure that the reservoir that has oil that auto lubricates the bearings is full. And then I've got some paragraphs that were written by our instrumentation and controls guy, our INC guy, about the different things in the system that'll pop up and give you errors, give you notifications if it notices with its sensors that there's a low pressure in a water seal or something, and it'll tell you. And so we're writing up some of the more nitty-gritty maintenance items for the operations and maintenance manual, but it also has a lot of how you actually operate the reservoir based on modes, and then using the SCADA system and the dashboard to change different valves and different pumps and figure out which pumps you should be pumping based on different river elevations and things like that. So I'm working on that, and I also started doing a little proposal that another firm that's here in town won the project, and they used our resume as some of the more technical stuff for the project. And it's kind of cool because the project manager for that company was with my company and actually had taught me basically everything I know about process engineering and wastewater. And he's now with the other company, and so I get really happy when I write in my calendar, like, call Joe today. Like, oh yeah, I used to write that all the time. Or go meet with Joe. We're working with Joe to figure out the scope of what we would take on, what they would take on, because there's not real delineated pieces that they can break off and say, this is what your company is responsible for, and this is what we're responsible for. More it's, okay, we're going to be analyzing this whole system. We're going to do some pieces of it. You guys are going to do some pieces of it. How many hours are you guys going to need? What is that going to cost us? If your main biologist, who's very senior, is $300 an hour. And so we're putting together the scope and fee, and it's kind of a neat project. So I don't know if you guys have been following the zebra mussel news, but zebra mussels are now in Austin. They were in Dallas before, so when they made their way to Texas, we all got a little bit nervous. And these are invasive species that are really tiny, microscopic little organisms. And basically, from what I know about it, is once they're in your lake, they're there. They're like, there's not a whole lot you can do to get rid of them without affecting the whole ecosystem of the lake. And they also affect the ecosystem and are quite bad for oxygen levels in the lake and light levels for some of the other plants. And so they'll make lakes look really pretty because they'll make them look very clear and clean. But what's happening is they're taking out all the good nutrients out of the lake, and the lake is not, it's a suffering lake if they've got the zebra mussels. Though on the surface it would appear to be a perfectly healthy lake. And what's complicated is when you have a water intake on a lake, so you've got your water supply for the city or the community or whoever has an intake pipe on the lake, these mussels get in and they like to just start growing on the intakes, and they start out microscopic and then they get huge in size. And so they'll be growing and they'll basically cut off all flow into that pipe, and so they severely reduce the amount of flow coming in, which changes the hydraulics, and your pump can't pump water through. You can cavitate your pumps, and it leads to lots of issues for water intakes and water treatment. So we're doing an evaluation now that they're here in Austin for three different cities that are all part of one conglomerate entity that but then works with the cities, so it's an authority, a water authority. So we're writing up this scope, which it's work we're basically already going to do once it's negotiated, since the prime has already won the project. They, you know, put in the qualifications, they put in our qualifications, and they got the bid. So we've got our biologist, who's a very specialized zebra mussel biologist. His name is Chirup, and he's awesome. And I'm going to work with him, and I'm going to be his junior engineer and also the project manager, which I think is just because I'm so inexperienced and so young that I get to do both of the roles, which can be a little bit awkward, especially when I got the hours from him of like hours he would need from the junior engineer and hours he need for me. And I called him up and I was like, hey, I think both of these roles are me. He's just like, okay, I'm going to need your help making these graphs, and we're going to look at DO over time, and we're going to do these sort of analyses and make this matrix so that we can decide what the best thing to do with the system is. And you'll be on site with me and do the site visits, and you'll help facilitate everything with the client as the project manager, but then also as the junior engineer, I get to write up some of the reports and do all the graphs. And he's going to look at the water quality data, but I'll probably take all of his all the data, and I'll sort through it. We use Excel for everything. We don't do coding or like that. I avoid coding as much as possible because I hate it. So I'll use Excel, and I'll sort through his data, and then he'll review it. And yeah, so it's kind of a neat project for zebra mussels. And so I worked on that scope and fee, and I'm really excited to work with the prime consultant because I know them. And I have taken a lot of time off this week. I just turned in my timesheet, and it's only 36 hours, which is real slim for me, but like probably normal for most people. And I took a long lunch yesterday. I went and I got my jewelry, this ring that you guys really like. It's from Nina Baronato. I think that's how you say her name. She's got some brick and mortars in Austin. She's an Austin artist. But she's also got an Airstream trailer up in the Miller District, which is the lead community. And so I went up, and my ring had snapped, and they just replaced it for me, she's awesome. So when I was there, I got this little ear cuff, which is a little snake and makes me feel very Slytherin, and I love it. So I got that, and they had some other local artesian artists. My mug is a mug that I got. It's got little cat butts on it, or one cat butt. I don't know if you can see that. I think that's so cute. I love it. So yeah, that's my mug. So I took some time off, been working on those two projects, been working on mainly those two. There's always little projects here and there and other things that I'm following up on. Like I thought I wasn't doing a lot of technical work, and I was doing a lot of project management, and I didn't want to get pigeonholed into these project management roles. So I reached out in my network, and I introduced myself to some of our like global people, and one of them, so our global water resources technologist, his name is Adam Hosking, and I've actually asked him before when I was posting something last year about flooding scenarios and how we do probability for weather events now. And I asked him to look over what I posted before I posted it. Other than that, and then just like being on a bunch of meetings with him, and him being on the periphery of any big water resources project that's happening, I knew who he was. I didn't think that he really knew who I was. So I was like, "Hey, I'm Andy. You know, these are the projects I worked on. I'm looking for some other big programs to help out with." And he was just like, "I know who you are." I'm like, "Oh, that's kind of cool." Yeah, he gave me a really good compliment, like, you know, I hear really good things about you. Like, oh, yay! So, I reached out to my networks for some more technical stuff, and this other project that I mostly do project management stuff, I asked them, like, hey, I'm happy to fly to Oregon and do some design with you guys if there's something I can do. They're like, well, we're going to do the seismic analysis, which is highly specialized and a senior guy, but we'll try to figure out how to get you wrapped up. And so they've been sending me some things to do, and yeah, I've been really surprised at, you know, what happens when you realize that, hey, I'm having fun, but I'm not doing exactly what I want to do for the next 10-15 years, and course correct and send out some emails and people actually try to look out for you and make sure that you're happy, and that's really awesome. Especially because they don't have to. And it's not part of their jobs, but everybody who I work with is so nice, and yeah, it's fun being an engineer, and people support you. And there's not really a lot of like competition where you feel like you have to like wipe out the rest of the competition. I've heard some of my friends who work in other industries, they're like, you know, there's other people, they're the same age as me, and they're doing very, very similar stuff, and so you have to prove that you're better than them, or, you know, whatever. And for me, it's like, no, not at all, because we work as a team. We work as an interdisciplinary team, and also as like the same people doing the same roles on one team. So even like, I was just thinking about how when I was an intern at Golder Associates and I was doing environmental engineering stuff, the other interns and I were super tight. Jeremy was in mining engineering. Jeremy and Sophia both were, and Jeremy had been working in the Arctic Circle, and you know, whenever he would work for so many days on, and then he'd have his days off, and then he'd fly anywhere in the world, and you know, because he felt like he wanted to go to Ireland, would go to Ireland and then go back to work. And Sophia had experience in Australia. She's from Sydney. So then on Fridays we'd all just get together. I was doing environmental, like groundwater remediation stuff, and we hung out every Friday, and it was awesome. And so I went and I saw Sophia last weekend in Pasadena, who's now working at Jet Propulsion Laboratory. She's a planetary scientist, so she's looking at mining on Mars, and what we would need to do in order to make that semi-feasible coming up. So yeah, I've got a video that's posting today when Sophia, actually I already posted it to my YouTube. So this was when her and I went to go see Devil's Gate Dam, Devil's Face Dam, the dam that is right there by Jet Propulsion Laboratory that's used for flood control. So we went and walked along it, and we laugh like crazy when we're together. And so yeah, I posted a little video about that. So if you have some time, go and check it out. But yeah, I'm gonna go and meet a friend at a coffee shop. I saw she just texted, so I'm excited to go meet her. So I will talk to you guys later. Bye.